Well, good morning. Everybody good this morning? Really? Come on, are you in that place that you want to be this morning? Are you worshiping a risen Savior? Okay, then, everybody good this morning? There we go. That's what I'm talking about. We get to do this. It's not that we have to do this. We are here because we get to worship the risen Savior. Amen? Amen. And because He does amazing things in our lives, even if they're small. Last week, I showed you a video where the guy was shooting the basketball, and I said, that kind of reminded me of back in my day, right? And he shoots it up, boom, blocked right in his face. Just to show you how God works. Chloe had practice this week. She had it in a facility that had two gyms. She was practicing in one gym. It's a public place. The other gym's open. And I thought, well, I've got on jeans and a t-shirt, but I'm going to go over here and shoot some ball with these guys. So I just started shooting, and I guess they recognized my talent. Okay, that's hurtful, first of all. But so I guess they recognized my talent, and they said, hey, you want to play a game? I said, I would love to play a game. I hadn't played a game in a long time. So I jump in with them, and I overheard these comments. Can you not guard him? And the guy said, no, he's too big. And another guy said, dude, he's got about 40 rebounds. And as I began to swell up with pride, God reminded me they were in seventh grade. But it was a lot of fun. Honestly, it was like just being Kobe or something. I was like, duh, yeah. But they were in like sixth or seventh grade. But I shouldn't have told y'all that part. But anyway, I am so glad you are here this morning as we look at this new series, 3 days. And we talk about what all happened in those 3 days, from death to despair to deliverance. And this morning, we're going to talk about death, the first in three parts. We're going to be talking about Jesus' death. And if I had to share with you one word that would just encompass all of that, it would be unbelievable, which is a word that we use way too much in our society. Almost like I love you. Almost like I love potato chips and dip. Oh, but I love you, honey. Thank you for doing that. So which am I, the chips or the dip? You know what I'm saying? We use it too much. So unbelievable is a word that we use many times in sports. Did you see that shot? It was unbelievable. That was unbelievable. But Jesus' death and what happened after is truly unbelievable. It is hard for us to fathom. It's hard for me to fathom sometimes. And I think even as his death was foretold in Isaiah, it kind of lets us know how much we were loved. In Isaiah 53, verse 5, the Bible says this, but he was pierced for our rebellion, crushed for our sins. He was beaten so we could be whole. He was whipped so we could be healed. I don't know how many of us would want to be pierced for someone else's rebellion or crushed for someone else's sin. Beaten so others could be whole, whipped so others could be healed. But to share with you verse 6 as well, it says, all of us like sheep have strayed away. We have left God's paths to follow our own. Yet the Lord laid on him the sins of us all. The sins of us all. Which leads us this morning in our first part to read about the crucifixion and then spend a little time talking about the death of Jesus. So if you have your Bibles, turn with me to Matthew chapter 27. Matthew chapter 27 and beginning in verse 33. It says, "And they went to a place called Golgotha, which means place of the skull. The soldiers gave him wine mixed with bitter gall, but when he had tasted it, he refused to drink it. After they had nailed him to the cross, the soldiers gambled for his clothes by throwing dice or casting lots. Then they sat around and kept guard as he hung there. A sign was fastened above Jesus' head announcing the charge against him. It read, 'This is Jesus, the King of the Jews.' Two revolutionaries were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left. The people passing by shouted abuse, shaking their heads in mockery. 'Look at you now,' they yelled at him. 'You said you were going to destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days. Well, then, if you are the Son of God, save yourself and come down from the cross.' The leading priests, the teachers of the religious law, and the elders also mocked Jesus. 'He saved others,' they scoffed, 'but he can't save himself. So he is the King of Israel, is he? Let him come down from the cross right now, and we will believe in him. He trusted God, so let God rescue him now if he wants him. For he said, 'I am the Son of God.' Even the revolutionaries who were crucified with him ridiculed him in the same way. At noon, darkness fell across the whole land until 3 o'clock. At about 3 o'clock, Jesus called out with a loud voice, 'Eli, Eli, lima sabachthani,' which means, 'My God, why have you abandoned me?' Some of the bystanders misunderstood and thought he was calling for the prophet Elijah. One of them ran and filled a sponge with sour wine, holding it up to him on a reed stick so he could drink. But the rest said, 'Wait, wait, wait, let's see whether Elijah comes to save him.' Then Jesus shouted out again, and he released his spirit. At that moment, the curtain in the sanctuary of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook, rocks split apart, and tombs opened. The bodies of many godly men and women who had died were raised from the dead. They left the cemetery after Jesus' resurrection, went into the holy city of Jerusalem, and appeared to many people. The Roman soldier, the Roman officer, and the other soldiers of the crucifixion were terrified by the earthquake and all that had happened. They said, 'This man truly was the Son of God.' And many women who had come from Galilee with Jesus to care for him were watching from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of James and John, the sons of Zebedee." Would you pray with me? Father, we thank you so much for your word. We thank you so much for your son, Jesus. God, this morning as we look at death and his death, God, make what happened on that cross more than a story, more than history, more than something we've heard over and again, so that we know it all too well, so that it means nothing to us. Make it ever so real. Move in our hearts and lives through your word this morning, Father, I pray in Jesus' precious name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. You know, in death, just the very word brings about particular emotions to us, doesn't it? When we learn of the death of someone close to us, that breaks our hearts. For us, it's truly a time of separation. And that is something that tears us apart. And we're going to talk about that just a little bit more in a few moments. But when we hear that word, there's just nothing good about it. But when we're talking about the death of Christ and how horrific it was the fulfilling of prophecy. It was the death of a Savior so that we might inherit eternal life. But in that death itself, it says, at noon, darkness fell across the whole land until 3 o'clock. So automatically we know that as people had passed by shouting their abuses and all the things that they were shouting, going, yeah, well, everybody has a sign about why they were crucified, what their crime was. And we see this sign over Jesus that says, this is the King of the Jews. And all the shouting and all the stuff and all that went with it. But then darkness fell. Darkness fell. Can you imagine walking outside in the daytime and all of a sudden you can barely even see? Would that tell you that there's something abnormal going on? Would that tell you that something big is happening? Darkness prevailed. But understand something. As we move through this, that while people were witnessing all of this, and they didn't believe he was who he said he was, even then they couldn't get away from him. Even then they had this wonder of, what if he's right? Because we see that it says some of the bystanders, when he had said, my God, why have you abandoned me? Some of the bystanders misunderstood and thought he was calling for the prophet Elijah. And one of them ran and filled a sponge with sour wine, holding it up on a reed stick so he could drink. Wait, let's see if Elijah comes to save him. So wait, let's see what he can do. Let's see if something big is going to happen here. Wait, let's look and see. And they're watching in awe, already knowing that with darkness all around, something is going to happen. It says, then Jesus shouted again, and he released his spirit. In a very dark time, when someone is dying and we are by their side, or we are blessed enough to be with people who are leaving this earth and getting ready to be in the presence of God. I've been with folks in that situation, and many, many times the voice of that dear one that's getting ready to depart this earth and be in the presence of God, their voice is barely audible. You know, sometimes we have to get very close because they are weak, and we have to just stop and see if we can catch what they're saying. But you see here, it says, then Jesus shouted out again. Not the voice of a weak man. He shouted out. Not as a man that was dying on a cross, that maybe was beaten and just mocked and just almost destroyed physically. Yes, was he a dying man? Yes. But that voice was not of a dying man. That voice was the voice of someone who could have saved himself coming down off of that cross. But he released his spirit, the Bible says. Meaning he gave it willingly. He gave it willingly to fulfill his Father's plan. He gave it willingly. And then we see the things begin to happen. Things begin to happen. At that moment that he shouted, the curtain in the sanctuary of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. This is that veil was torn from top to bottom so that there would be no doubt that it was he who did it, that it was God himself who did that. That separation between the Holy of Holies and the others who could go in, and the very presence of God where that was, it just tore from top to bottom unbelievably. Unbelievably. And you see, sometimes death tears us apart the same way. There's a tearing apart inside. But you see, we have to begin to look at this thing differently. You see, when death comes into our lives and that veil that separates us now from eternity with our Savior, death is that passage through there. And so when we experience death, when our loved ones experience death, that veil is removed and we are in the presence of God. Now, I'm thinking about it this way. For those that had said and disbelieved and said, hey, this is what, if we back up to verse 39, it says, the people passing by shouted abuse, shaking their heads in mockery. Look at you now, they yelled at him. You said you were going to destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days. Well, then, if you are the Son of God, save yourself and come down from that cross. Well, that temple that was being destroyed was his very body. Would it be rebuilt in 3 days? Yes, amen. It says that the earth shook, rocks split apart, and tombs opened. That ground shaking. If you can imagine not only just being in the dark, but the temple veil being torn in two from top to bottom. And now the ground is beginning to shake. It lets us know that something very real is happening that was unexpected. Especially for all those who were there as a witness. Can you imagine? Because you see, it wasn't just there, but it was in the land surrounding that very spot of death. It was in countries adjacent to the crucifixion. That's a pretty big earthquake. That's a lot of shaking. Tombs were opened. Godly people raised. Rocks split apart. And it says the earth shook, rocks split apart. It makes me think about if we don't praise him, then the rocks will cry out. They're crying out when they split apart. Amen. It's God's way of saying, hey, this earth is showing this was truly my son. Pay attention. Don't let it become something that is contributing to your complacency because you're aware of it, because you know it. Let it change you. Be a part of all that's going on. See, when those tombs opened, the bodies of many godly women and men, it says, who had died were raised from the dead. And then in verse 53, It says they left the cemetery after Jesus' resurrection, went into the holy city of Jerusalem, and appeared to many people. Stop for just a moment. If you were one of the people that those people appeared to, tell me what your reaction would be. Besides, ah! That would be a lot of our responses, wouldn't it? But you see, God is getting people's attention. God is, through the death of His Son, saying, I have shown you, this is my Son. He told you He was my Son. He told you He came to save. Pay attention. Here are some more signs. Those people that witnessed all those things, their lives were forever changed. Forever changed. The Roman officer and the other soldiers at the crucifixion were terrified by the earthquake and all that had happened. They said, this man truly was the Son of God. Can you say that this morning? Truly, He was the Son of God. Can you say this morning, not only do I believe that, but I live that? Because we all have a before story and after story, a before Christ and an after Christ. Some may not have as much of a story as others. Some maybe have been down some pretty bad roads before they came to the understanding of who Christ was and what He did in their lives. However, we cannot ignore the gruesome, horrific death on the cross. And why? Because of you and your sins. Because of me and my sins. And because of the love of an unbelievable Almighty God who gave it all that we might live. Now, these lives that were forever changed, how must it have felt? How must it have felt to have witnessed all these things and to have been a mocker? To have been one who yelled, crucify Him! Crucify Him! And then see all these things that happened and go, oh my. Yes, Jesus is the Son of God. You see, our lives should be forever changed. We shouldn't have one moment of change. And then we run with that change for a while, and then we get tired. We get tired spiritually. We get tired emotionally. We get tired physically. And we just go, you know what, God, I know You know my heart, but I'm just tired. It's hard doing all the things I have to do in my life, all the running, all the ball games, all the stuff, my job. Oh, my goodness. Was it as hard as hanging on a cross? Was your last week as hard as hanging on a cross? Or even one step further, was your last week as hard as seeing a child of yours that you love with all your heart on a cross, being mocked and beaten, whipped, scarred? I don't know that I've had a week that bad. Even our worst week is not that bad. So if that's the case, then are our lives changed in just a moment and in just a season of serving Him, in just a season of giving to Him, in just a season of following Him? We spend our lives getting in church and out of church and back in church and at a different church, and I don't like that church, so I'm going to go to this church, but then sometimes I just don't want to go to church. Sometimes I want to listen to worship music. Sometimes I just like my stuff. Sometimes I just want to be alone. Yes, the sun looks beautiful when it sets. Yes, but I got to get somewhere. I'm not going to send up a little praise to you, Lord, because I'm busy. I got to drive. Go on as I go around that person to get to my practice, right? You know, sometimes I wonder what it must be like if God were looking down on our lives and He said, you see all this beautiful creation that I gave you to enjoy. You see that I gave you my very best. I gave you my only son to die on a cross that you might have life and have it more abundantly. I blessed you with family. And all I want you to do is enjoy this, praise me, worship me, fellowship with other believers, serve me. Just give me back a little bit of what I've blessed you with and enjoy this. And what a great time we'll have together in fellowship. And He looks down and sees us just running a maze. We hit a dead end, we back up, we turn, we go a different direction. Dead end, back up, turn, go a different direction. Instead of hitting a dead end and saying, God, forgive me, I need you to show me the way out. You are the way out. You are the only way out. And truly, the way out of this earth and into eternity is that veil being torn called death. His death, the death of that one would offer life for many. The death of one would offer eternal life for many. But you didn't say all, Pastor. All don't believe. All don't follow. All won't submit to His lordship. For you see, many reject who He is even to this day. How we could ignore such a horrific death that was because of love, I don't know. See, even if the Roman soldiers would say, surely this was the Son of God, then what more would it take for us to understand this Jesus and this gruesome, horrific death was for me? And the best I can do is to give a little back once in a while, a little praise once in a while. He gave His life for you. He gave His life for you. He gave His life for you. He gave His life for me. Is it too much to ask that we give our lives back to Him because He first loved us? As we think about these 3 days in this series, we think about that crucifixion. I wonder, though you may say this truly was the Son of God, will your life be forever changed like those who witnessed all these events. The ground shaking, the earth quaking, the tearing of the veil, splitting of the rocks, the opening of the tombs, the godly people being raised. Will that change you from the moment you leave this place this morning forever? Will it be a nice story that you hear and you leave feeling encouraged this morning? Listen, that death demands a decision. As you pay attention to this short video, I pray you just ask God how He wants to change you. We know what's coming. Those who were witnesses that day had heard about what was going to happen later. What tremendous faith they would have had to have had to say, I know what's coming in 3 days. I'm just going to hang on. After witnessing something like that, I'm sure there were many who questioned it. This morning, my question to you is, understanding what He did for you and that God allowed all those things and said, hey, here's what's going to happen so I can get your attention. All of you who did not believe this was truly my son, all of you who didn't believe that prophecy would be fulfilled, what will you do now? This morning I would ask you that. Now that you know what all happened then, that God was getting their attention, my question is this morning. Does He have yours? Does He have your attention? Does He have your family's attention? Are you following Him? Does He have all of you? See, He wants fellowship with you every day. He doesn't just want it on a checkoff sheet. I read my devotion. I listened to a Christian song. And I'm going to go to church in 2 Sundays. He wants, God, I love you so much. I believe that Jesus Christ is your son, that He died on a cross for my sin, that He rose again. And I want to give you my life, Lord. Take it all. Take my money. Take my family. I'm trusting it all to you. Take control completely. Is that where you are this morning? Because this death, quite honestly, sometimes has just become Jesus died on the cross. I know, I've heard it my whole life. Let me ask you, if you've heard it your whole life, what have you done with it? because one day that question will be asked of us. And this morning, if you do not know that forgiveness of sin, then today is the day of salvation for you. Today is the day that you change it up, that you say, I want my life to be different. I'm tired of how it is. I don't want him to have a piece of my life. I want him to have it all. Would you pray with me? Father, I pray in the strong name of your son, Jesus, that God, you would move people this morning, Lord, to a place of worship and praising you, serving you, giving back to you, living for you, giving their families to you, giving their relationships to you, giving their jobs to you, giving their money to you, turning it all over to your lordship. God, I pray if there's one here this morning that does not know you, one that would say, I've heard this story before, but I didn't realize it was quite like you said. I didn't realize that he was just beaten and ripped to shreds and whipped and broken, and that I had a part in that. I want to know that I've given my life to him. If that's you this morning, then in just a moment, you don't wait. You make your way right down front to my right, your left. I'm going to meet you there. And we'll get that straightened out. Lord, for those that are just kind of complacent, Lord, for those that would just kind of call on you when they need you, have an on-call Jesus button, God, I pray you would move them this morning to a closer walk with you. Lord, we just want to tell you we love you. And I pray, God, you would move in a mighty, mighty way right now in the strong name of Jesus. Amen.